Good evening. Today, the Diocese of Jefferson City is conducting a special collection in support of our missions. Donations given during this collection will support people in the home diocese of the mission priests serving us. It is being conducted across the Diocese of Jefferson City. We ask that you prayerfully reflect and consider making this a part of your giving. If you have the special missions envelope that was included in the Catholic Mission Missourian, you can use that envelope for this collection. But if you don't need to use that, but you do not need to use that envelope, any gift is appreciated. Thank you for your generosity. Okay, welcome to St. Pius X Church for the Eucharistic celebration of the 15th Sunday in Ordinary Time. If you are a visitor, thank you for joining us today, and please come back any time. If you are residing in Randolph County, we request that you register with our parish if you haven't already done so. Register packets are available in the back of church. Join us in praying the stewardship prayer. It is the orange prayer card in your pew. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear Heavenly Father, my parish is composed of people like me. I help make it what it is. It will be friendly if I am friendly. Its pews will be filled if I help fill them. It will make generous gifts to many causes if I am a generous giver. It will bring other people into its worship and fellowship if I invite and bring them. It will be a parish of loyalty and love, of fearlessness and love, and a parish with a noble spirit if I, who make it what it is, am filled with these same things. Therefore, with your help, O God, I shall dedicate myself to growing our faith by being all things that I want my parish to be. Please turn off all cell phones if you have not already done so, and please stand and greet your neighbor.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My dear brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sinfulness so as to prepare ourselves for these sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you came in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who show the light of your truth to those who go astray, so that they may return to the right path, give all who for the faith they profess are accounted Christians the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ and to strive after all that does it honor. To our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down, and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. reached it. God's water courses are filled. You have prepared the grave. The seed that falls on good ground will yield a fruitful harvest. Thus have you prepared the land, drenching its furrows, breaking up its clods, softening it with showers, blessing its yield. The seed that falls on good ground will yield a fruitful harvest. You have crowned the year with your bounty, and your paths overflow with a rich harvest. The untilled meadows overflow with it, and rejoicing close the hills. The seed that falls on good ground will yield a fruitful harvest. The fields are garmented with
a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. For creation awaits with eager expectation the revelation of the children of God. For creation was made subject to futility, not of its own accord, but because of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that all creation is groaning in labor pains, even until now. And not only that, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, who also groan within ourselves as we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. On that day, Jesus went out of the house and sat down by the sea. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood along the shore. And he spoke to them at length in parables, saying, "A sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once, because the soil was not deep. But when the sun rose, it was scorched, and it withered for lack of roots. Some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil and produced fruit, 100 or 60 or 30-fold. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The disciples approached him and said, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He said to them in reply, "Because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven have been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. To anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. For anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because they look, but they do not see. They hear, but they do not listen or understand. Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them, which says, 'You shall indeed hear, but not understand. You shall indeed look, but never see. Gross is the heart of this people. They will hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes. Lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and be convicted, and I heal them.' But blessed are your eyes because they see and your ears because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. The seed sown on the path is the one who hears the word of the kingdom without understanding it, and the evil one comes and steals away what was sown in his heart. The seed sown on rocky ground is the one who hears the word and receives it at once with joy, but he has no root and lasts only for a time. When some tribulation or persecution comes because of the word, he immediately falls away. The seed sown among thorns is the one who hears the word, but then worldly anxiety and the lure of riches choke the word, and it bears no fruit. But the seed sown on rich soil is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields 100 or 60 or 30-fold. The Gospel of the Lord.
Good evening. This is my first time here, so I'm very happy to be here. Plus, I love your patron saint. St. Pope Pius X was a great pope. As I was preparing my homily for this weekend, I read an article in Crisis Magazine entitled, "Does Jesus Love You Just Where You Are?" The author is an associate professor of philosophy at Iona College in New York. And he responds with a resounding no. And he writes, Jesus does not love us just the way we are. He pities the way we are. Such divine pity caused the Son of God to take flesh in the womb of his virgin mother. However, I think it is precisely because of the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ that we can modify his answer to a yes and a no. And I think our readings today defend that position. Our gospel passage today is the very beginning of the 13th chapter of the Gospel of St. Matthew. Now, in the 11th and the 12th chapters, many of our Lord's disciples have decided to no longer follow him. The Pharisees have begun to plot against him. They want to put him to death, most especially because he's been curing on the Sabbath. And now our Lord enters into a series of parables to speak to his disciples, which includes us, about the kingdom of heaven and those who will enter into it. And this is the first of the series of parables. And it really sets the foundation for all of the parables. Because in this parable of the good soil, we're reminded that we must bear fruit if we are going to enter in to the kingdom of heaven. So I don't want to go over all the different types of soil. I'm sure you've heard this parable many times, and our Lord Jesus Christ in the gospel explains it. But there are two things that I think we all must be doing, regardless of where we find ourselves in that list of soil. Whether we find ourselves as good soil, or even more so, if we find ourselves among the bad soils. And those two things are confession and the Eucharist, in that order. Confession, because we need the mercy of God. It is the nature of sin that we need to be forgiven. We need the mercy of God, which we receive in the sacrament of reconciliation. At the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I know this is no longer true, but at the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, you had to plow the field before you put the seed into the ground. And the same is true about our souls. We must prepare our souls to receive the word of God. We have to, in a sense, plow out the sins in our lives so that we can allow the seed of the word of God to grow. And we do that in the sacrament of reconciliation. We weed our souls, so to speak, when we confess our sins and we receive the mercy of God. Unfortunately, too many have abandoned the sacrament of reconciliation, or they go twice a year at Advent and Lent during the penance services. But the nature of sin is such that it will grow if we aren't vigilant. If you're a farmer, or if you have a garden, whether it is vegetables or flowers or both, or even if you just have a yard, look at it. In the heat of this summer, what grows? Weeds. Weeds will always grow if we are not vigilant. And sin is the same way. If we are not vigilant, our small sins become large sins. And large sins cause us not to be in the love of God. If we allow ourselves to fall into sin, if we allow ourselves to fall into habitual sin, if we allow ourselves to fall into large sins, we remove ourselves from the love of God, and God does not love us where we are in our sins. But we have the cure, and it is the sacrament of reconciliation. Every one of us should be going to the Sacrament of Reconciliation at least once a month. We don't let our gardens, our fields, our yards go until the weeds have taken over. We keep it at hand. And the same is true with our souls. We need to be vigilant, attentive, removing the sins from our souls so that God can place the seed in that fertile ground. The second thing, and it has to come after the Sacrament of Reconciliation, is the Eucharist. We must be fed. Just as in our gardens or our fields we have to fertilize, we have to be fed. We are fed on the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We need the nourishment of the Eucharist if we are going to live faithful lives. But we only receive the graces of the Eucharist if we are in the state of grace, which is why the Sacrament of Reconciliation comes first. When we're in the state of grace, we can receive the nourishment of the Eucharist, the grace and the strength to live faithful and holy lives, to allow that seed to bear great fruit. And this is where we can say, yes, that God loves us because he loves us so much that not only did he take on our flesh, suffer and die for us and rise again so that we might have the gift of eternal life, he comes to us every time we celebrate the Mass. Every time we come here and we receive him worthily, we receive his body and blood, his soul and divinity. We are united to him when we receive him worthily. Isaiah, in our first reading, is writing to the Israelites who are in exile. They're in Babylon. Why? Because they have turned away from God. They're no longer listening to the word of God. But this is the last chapter of the Book of Comfort. And what does Isaiah say? He says that just like the rain and the snow that do not return to heaven without bringing refreshment to the earth so it can bear great fruit, so is the word of God. It does not come from the mouth of God without bearing great fruit. Isaiah is telling the Israelites that God has made a promise to them and his word will not be defeated. And what is that promise? That they will return from Babylon. They will go back to Israel. They will return home if only they allow the word of God to bear fruit in them. The same is true for us. God has made us a promise. We will enter into eternal life if only we allow his word to bear great fruit in our lives. Let us use the tools that he has given to us. Let us go to confession regularly to receive his mercy, to open up the ground, to receive the word of God. And let us come here to be fed on the body and the blood, soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ, to nourish the seed, to nourish the ground, so that we may be those who bear fruit 100-fold and enter into the kingdom of heaven. Let us stand now and in prayer profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Placing our hope and our trust in our risen Lord, we offer to God our Father our prayers and petitions.
For the church, may God give us the grace to sow seeds of goodness and tend the soil of the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders in government, may God grant them hearts of understanding and conversion to the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For farmers and all who work to grow and produce the food we eat, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the community gathered here, may God open our eyes and ears so we can hear his voice in all that we do. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For men and women in military uniform, that they may serve their country with honor and be kept safe, especially those serving in harm's way. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Roberta and Dempsey Leuenberg. May God welcome them into the eternal rest in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of this Mass, which are for the health and welfare of Sandy Gamble, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And to the intentions that you hold in the silence of your hearts. We fly to thy protection,
O Holy Mother of God. Do not despise our petitions in our necessities, but deliver us always from all dangers. O glorious and blessed Virgin. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look upon the offerings of the Church, O Lord, as she makes her prayer to you, and grant that, when consumed by those who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Bonaventure, St. Pius X, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Come give to us.
Let us pray. Having consumed these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this mystery, its saving effects upon us may grow. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Just have a few quick announcements. This Tuesday, it is our turn to unload the truck at the Christo Center, 3:30 p.m. This Tuesday, July the 18th, many hands make for a light load. Make sure you please see the picnic flyer insert in the bulletin. Pay attention to that. Take that home and read that. Our celebration of the Eucharist outside of Mass will continue this week. Deacon Chris will do Tuesday night at 5:15. And he will also, 5:30 on Tuesday, and then Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday at 8 o'clock in the morning. Come listen to the Word of God and receive Jesus in the beautiful gift of the Eucharist that he gives us. Please remember to bring a can of corn and beans for the Christo Center. And Marla is also in the back selling tickets for the picnic on August the 20th. And also she has a sign up for the Knights of Columbus men for their activities as well. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our defense.